Well, today's a big day. We are finishing up the Ten Commandments, guys. Come on, you were waiting for this day. Oh, you were just, you marked it on your calendar. I mean, oh man, you were so pumped. We have been in this journey now for 10 weeks. We walked through these Ten Commandments, and I think it's important now, before we jump into this last, before we get all inside of it, that we remember how we started. The people of God had been saved. I mean, literally, that's how the Ten Commandments open up. God had rescued them. He had saved them. Don't ever let it be lost on you this moment. When God parks them out, he gets them at Mount Sinai, he gets them there, it's because they had been saved, and because they were saved, they were changed. Listen, can I just tell you, because you are saved, you are changed. You're changed, and because you're changed, guess what? It changes you, right? Because you're saved, you're changed, and because you're changed, it changes you. And what Jesus is trying to do, and sometimes you might get confused when I say that. You're like, wait a second, Jesus doesn't show up until the second half of the film. No. Jesus is all throughout this Old Testament. It's not like we read it back in. No, he's there. What Jesus is trying to do with these Ten Commandments, he's trying to show them that he's a different kind of God, so they're going to be a different kind of people. They're going to walk a different path and do a different thing. Their lives are going to be different because they have been saved. And they've been changed. And so it changes who they are and what they do. It changes how they interact with him, right? So there is no other gods but our God, right? We're not going to put him in a box. We're not going to make him small. We're not going to leverage him for our personal gain. We're not going to do any of that. And if our relationship with God is aligned, that means it will change how we relate to one another. That means we won't kill, and we won't steal, and we won't bear false witness or lie. We won't commit adultery, but it's bigger than that because we know those go deeper. It's not just that we won't kill, but we'll manage our anger. It won't just be that we won't have an affair. It'll be that we will not objectify others for our pleasure. It won't be that just that we won't, you know, not lie, but that we will find the truth, and the truth will set us free. It won't just be that we won't steal things from other people, it'll be that we trust God with all of our life. The Ten Commandments are big. They're these things that show us a way to live in God and with others that can change us because we've been changed. So we're getting to the last one now today. Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20 and verse 17 says this: you shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male servant or his female servant or his ox or his donkey, which I know all of you struggle with. Or anything else that is your neighbor's. You shall not covet. Now, that's a word that we don't often use, right? It's not in our everyday vocabulary. You probably didn't use that this morning except to refer to the Ten Commandments. So it's because that's a word that we don't often use. We don't often, you know, have a good sense of what it means. In the Hebrew under that, the actual language that the Bible's in here, just means to earnestly desire, okay? So we say earnestly desire. Now I have a category for that, don't I? I know what that looks like. So I don't earnestly desire my neighbor's house. I don't earnestly desire my neighbor's spouse. Okay, Dr. Seuss a little bit here. Or his donkey or ox. That's usually not our problem, right? Or anything else that my neighbor has. But you notice what it does not say. It does not say that you can't desire something, right? It doesn't say that. In fact, it's a good thing for us to sometimes want some things, to have some things. The Bible never says you can't have things. It doesn't say that. You will never find that in the Scripture. It says you can't acquire things, you can't buy things, you can't have things. But what the Bible takes issue is with your stuff has you. That's where we have the problem. See, coveting is not so much about wanting my neighbor's stuff, as much as it's wanting something I don't have to the point that it changes me, to the point that I desire it, and I'll reorient my life to get it. Now, I have a friend of mine who, he says that as Americans, as Westerners, as in the wealth that we have, one of our greatest sins as a people is stuff. Materialism and consumerism, and the challenge is we often don't see that way because we think about not killing people, right? We think that's bad, or not lying, or not committing adultery, not having affairs. Like, we go, that's the bad stuff. This is like pseudo bad, like half bad. That's like all the way bad. But we've got a problem. Let me give you some statistics. The average American home, this is LA Times reporting, average American home has 300,000 items in it. Did you just hear what I said? 300,000 items. British research found that the average 10-year-old owns 238 toys, but plays with just 12 daily. And every parent in the room is like, yeah, I know. Right? In fact, 3.1% American children represent about 3.1% of all children in the world, but they own 40% of the toys. Nearly half of American households do not save any money. Some reports indicate we consume right now twice as many good material goods as we did 50 years ago. In fact, homes today, compared to their counterparts 30 years ago, are as much as 30 and 40% larger than they used to be. Americans spend annually $1.2 trillion with a T, a number that I can't even get my head around. I don't even know how. $1.2 trillion annually on what's considered non-essential goods. In other words, items they do not need. You want some more? The amount that Americans spend in a single weekend is more than half the total they give to churches in an entire year. Even the stuff that is staples that we consider we have to have this, we waste. Nearly 40% of food in America goes to waste. I think we've got a problem. And it's not a small problem. It's not some benign problem. It's not some, oh, that's the bad stuff, and this is kind of like, this is a big problem. Because it's a heart problem. Of all the Ten Commandments, this is the only one that does not have a physical action attached to it. There are 10 commandments, 9 of them. Do not kill. Honor your father and mother. Right? Don't take the Lord's name in vain. This one is entirely about your heart. In fact, most scholars will consider this to be a summary commandment. Because listen, if I earnestly desire something I don't have, then I might kill for that. I might have an affair for that. I might steal for that. I might lie for that. This becomes the encapsulation of all of the other stuff. We've got a problem. And just like we've done with all the other commandments, where we recognize that it was not so much about the commandment as much as it was about the heart, about the motivations, then we have to ask ourselves, why is it that we are driven to this? Why is it that we will, like, practically kill each other on Black Friday? For, like, a crock pot. Like, legit, right? Why is it that I have, you know, right now, this phone uses more memory in it to take a picture than the entire memory that was used to put a man on the moon? okay? But I'll look at this phone and go, man, this is like 3 years old. There are so many better phones out there. What is that in me? What is driving that? I think there are a couple of things. One is we tend to think our stuff will make us happy. Right? I mean, we actually have people. We joke about it, right? Because I know people. Okay, I won't say who it is. Okay, I know people who, when they get down or they get frustrated or they get angry or they get kind of emotionally discombobulated, they go and shop, and they call it retail therapy. Check that out, though. I mean, we laugh, and then, you know, it's funny, right? Yeah. But they're unhappy. And so their impulse is to go, you know what will make me happy? To go buy stuff. You know what physiologically happens to you when you buy new things? Is that it creates endorphins in your body. It produces chemicals within you. And you know what can happen to those endorphins? We can become addicted to them. Physiological. So when we talk about shopaholics, that's a real thing. It says, my stuff will make me happy. If I just got this, my life will be better. I need it. I mean, how many times have my children come to me and said, Dad, I need this? And you sit back as a dad and go, well, no, you don't. You need to eat, right? That's what you need to do. You need to drink water, but you do not need this. But then I will turn around and buy the stupidest thing on the planet because I go, boy, I really could use that. Am I right? So we think our stuff will make us happy, and so we satisfy the longing that's in our heart with something. Not someone. Sometimes it's not that. I mean, for some people in this room, you go, yep, that's me. Others of you in this room, it's not so much that. It's the need to feel important. Because you see people all the time that they buy the watch they buy, not because it's a good watch, because it's that watch. Right? Some of you, you have a perfectly good lawnmower, and you're like, you know what? I'd really like to get this one because it's better than the one my neighbor has. Am I right? People do this kind of thing all the time. They wear a certain brand of clothing. Is it a better brand of clothing? No, but it's better. And people will notice. That Louis Vuitton bag has Louis Vuitton logos all over it. Why? Because then you're carrying a Louis Vuitton bag. Am I right? It's the need to feel important, to feel better than, to shore up some weakness. So instead of running to our Heavenly Father for value, what do? We go to the stuff to feel value. There's probably a third category too, security. It's probably the inverse of the other categories. It's not about being happy. It's not about being important. It's about being stable. So by being secure, making sure I've got everything taken care of, and so you invest not just in stuff, but the right stuff. You are the consumer reports kind of person. I believe in stewardship, and I'm all about reviews on Amazon. That's how I buy, okay? But there is something that can drive our stuff that says if we buy it this way or we don't buy it this way, if we have this much saved up, then we'll be okay. But we all know that's foolish, right? Because that would only work if we were in charge. But we're not in charge, are we? We're not. So that sense of security that we get is really a lack of trust in our Heavenly Father. We got a problem. We got a problem. At the end of the day, it's all restlessness. It's all a lack of peace. It's all just trying to fill something up inside of us. So we've got a problem. But here's the good news. There's always a solution. There's always a way. And anytime you come into a sermon like this or any other sermon or read the Bible or any other way that you interact with the truth of God, you should always be finishing the process with, what do I do? I see my problem, right? I see my issue, but we always got to get to that place. It's like if we don't get there, a lot of times what will happen in a sermon, because I've been there, I've done it, I listen to sermons all the time, and I'll listen to that and go, man, that's inspiring or that's moving. And then I learn something and then I move on and I never apply it. It's like leaving paint in a paint can. What good is it? Unless it's applied. Unless it's put on the wall. Unless I put it into my life. Unless I get it into my world. What good is the inspiration? What good is the wake up? So what would the Bible say about what we do with this? I think all of us could sense that we have a problem at one level or another, in one way or another here. But what do we do? I'm going to give you four things. And like a good preacher, they all start with R. Okay? I'll give you four things that I hope, they kind of build on one another, kind of rely upon one another. They kind of interact with one another, but I think they're important for you and I to understand. And the first thing that I want you to see for fighting this sense of like materialism grabbing our heart, the stuff getting a hold of us, is to resist our tendency that we have to compare to one another. So this is how I understand it. I've never had a new car, okay? Not one time have I ever had a new car. Okay, I've had some beaters, though, okay? Anybody else with me? Come on, somebody, right? And you don't think about it until that person that does have a new car has to ride in your car, at which point now you're like, spend the whole first 5 minutes of the ride going, and my air conditioner makes that noise because it's broken, and I never really don't pay attention to it, right? Or there's this smell in my car, and that's because my kids smelled, you know, spilled chocolate milk that one time, and I couldn't find it, and it just stayed where, you know, like that's what we do, right? We don't start comparing until we get in a situation, right? You see how damaging that could be? See how difficult? I mean, it all starts with, I look to my right and to my left. And when we do that, so the first step is resisting that temptation to look right and to look left. So when you resist that temptation, you'll be able to look at your friend's new car and you won't be sad, but you'll be happy for them. You'll be happy for them. We resist that temptation to compare. The second item is just like it. It's rejoice in what you have. Because that beater car, boy, it may sound awful. And that check engine light may be on just permanently. You might pray yourself through every e-check, okay? Like, right? But it gets you where you need to go. And God gave you that car. Do you realize God gave you everything you have? Like, you may have worked, but God gave you the ability to work. That's what Deuteronomy tells us. And so every time you complain about something you have, you're complaining about something that God gave you, and he's standing right next to you. Do you realize that? Do you realize how ungrateful that is? You could be walking. In fact, statistically speaking, if you drove here, you are currently in the top 3% of the world's wealth just by owning a car. Y'all are a bunch of rich people. We rejoice in what we have. We're grateful for the gifts that God has given us. The third thing is this, and this is a big one. Man, this one's so important, and it's the amens are might slow down here. So we resist comparing. We rejoice in what we have. And the third thing is we return 10% back to God. We return 10% back to God. Let me give you a couple of reasons why I believe you should tithe. And this has nothing to do with the fact that I'm an employee of the church. Listen, if I was not an employee of the church, I would preach this same message to you today. Number one is Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10 says that you rob God when you don't tithe. So you break another commandment. But But the reason why that matters, so we talk about robbing God, but let me get you a little deeper, is that your giving can tell me where your heart is. The reason why giving matters in your life and in my life, the reason why giving and generosity has the power to break the hold of materialism on your heart and my heart, is because it changes our heart. Jesus talks about it this way, okay? It's found in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 19. It says, "Do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth." Right here and now. In this moment we're living, do not lay up for yourselves treasures here, because the moth and the rust destroy and the thief will kill or steal. So check this out. God's saying, when you invest here, you're investing in things that don't last. When you put all your energy in, your power and your influence and your money, your resources into stuff now, you're investing into that thing that doesn't matter. Like immediately it depreciates. Immediately it loses value and it will go away. Jesus gives an alternative. He says, instead, lay up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy and thieves cannot steal. For here it is. Verse 21 is the crux of everything. For where your treasure is, there your heart is also. That when you are unaligned, that is, you don't give to the Lord, what happens? And you put all your energy in your stuff, then you are investing in things that will go away and do not matter. And what happens then, he says, where your treasure is, there your heart is also. What you invest in is where your heart will be. And so your heart will be here and not there. But he flips that. He says, listen, if you want to change your heart, you want to change your attitude, you want to change the control that it has on your heart, guess what happens? You give it away. And when you give it away, it changes where your heart is. It's no longer in the here and now. Now it's in the things of the kingdom and the things of eternity. It changes who you are. I'm telling you, it works. In fact, I shared this with First Service to prove to you that, like, this is not about me trying to raise money, because it's really not. Try it out. If you're not tithing right now, listen, I don't know what people give. I don't even know who gives. I don't look at that. So I'm saying to you, honestly and blindly, okay, I don't know, but I'm saying to you, try this out. The Bible says actually test God in this area. It's the only place in the Bible where we get to test God, okay? The only place, period. And it says test God. So here's the deal. Some of you have been around New Life, have heard me say this before. If you're not tithing right now, and you will tithe for 30 days, and God does not bless you, does not take care of you, and your heart does not change, I'll give you your money back. You let me know, and every dime you give. We don't want you to invest in the wrong place. We'll give. That's how much I believe in this. That's how much I trust your Heavenly Father to realign your heart and realign your life. Because if you will put your treasure in the kingdom, your heart will be in the kingdom. So, we resist comparing, we rejoice in what we have, we return the 10% back to God, and then ultimately, like we talked about, we focus on permanent values. We focus our heart and our attention on those things that matter. How about you, but I don't want to waste my life. I would hate to put my life into things that have no meaning and value. That I look back and go, man, this doesn't even matter. I mean, you and I probably all have a drawer full of old cell phones. And at the time, we thought we had to have it. That was the latest, greatest thing, and we invested all that money, and then we look back and go, man, that thing is just a brick.
doesn't even matter. And think about how much more that we do. And so if I'll refocus my attention on those things that are eternal, those things that are kingdom-oriented, those things that matter for eternity, and check this out, not just my eternity, but someone else's eternity, man, it will make me think differently about my stuff. I won't care nearly as much about having the newest thing as much as I will care about investing in the lives of others so that they can experience God. I won't care about this stuff. I won't care about all of that because it doesn't matter now, but they do. How about you? But I want my life to matter. And I do not want stuff to have my heart. There's nothing more foolish, nothing more empty than having stuff have my heart. Why don't we pray? Lord, we come to you now, and we don't want stuff to have our heart. We want you to have our heart. We want you to be the one who satisfies us. That natural and insidious and quiet way that stuff can get us. It's like a vine that wraps around a gate. It's slow and it captures us by surprise. I would pray today that you would speak to our hearts to show us the areas in which the material things of this world, the stuff that's just going to burn up or die or just deteriorate. Would you show us how those things are fueling us? We try to find our happiness, we try to find our value, our importance, we try to find our security, our safety in things that just can't do it. So that we would find hope in you. God, that's our prayer. This morning, as we move into a time of reflection, in a moment we're going to share in communion together. Communion is this ultimate reflection upon what Jesus gave to us that was of eternal value. But he was the first one who gave. And so you get the opportunity today to participate in that, to reflect back on the cross, to reflect back on the resurrection so that new life can be made known in your heart and in your life. I want you to take just a minute or so. In just a moment, we'll have communion together. But I want you just to allow the Spirit of God to speak to your heart so that it can recalibrate your thinking, so that you can give up this thing to get God's thing.